I'll turn it over to WAVE Vision and People Conference Co-Chair, Cynthia Vera, for the Aspire tip.
Thank you, Marie. Good morning, BV professionals, and welcome to the third day of the sixth version of the People Conference. The last week, we had amazing presentation and insightful topics to help us develop together in this journey, and this continue this week. So I appreciate your company today. We have had the opportunity to listen to people from different offices around the world and talking about diversity, inclusion, equity, psychological safety, mental health, and many other important topics like the one that we are listening to this morning. Today, I want to take a minute to share an inspiring moment that is deeply connected with what we want to achieve participating in these presentations. The shadow that you cast. I want to introduce you the mirror neurons. We all have mirror neurons in different quantities, you know, in different parts of our brain. They help us in the learning process since we are born. So when you realize your baby is learning, when you have a mad face or a happy face, that baby is using his or her mirror neurons. They allow us to understand feelings and to establish connections. When you see others acting, talking, thinking, and feeling, our mirror neurons wake up and play a fundamental role in the learning imitation and empathetic process. Yes, empathetic. The mirror neurons help us to be more empathetic persons. The more mirror neurons you have, the better you understand actions and emotions from others. Mirror neurons make us social beings. They help us not only to understand other behaviors, but also to learn new language and through imitations to get new abilities. All of this, of course, affects our behavior and decisions. And this is why it is so important we are all here today. There are ways to activate your mirror neurons, like knowing yourself, smiling and interact with other people, listen actively, and any other participation in social events, conferences. Oh my God, we are in a conference right now. It's a good opportunity to practice to activate your mirror neurons. So the more we get connected, the more empathetic we become. Mirror neurons help us to replicate learned abilities to other situations. In the same way you learn from others, other people is it at this minute learning from you. And that is why it's so important the shadow that you cast. Because through behavior, you are transmitting knowledge to the people around you. Well, thank you for joining us again today. And now I will ask you to actively listen and activate your mirror neurons to the following presenter. She is our Vice President of Talent, Katie Schultz. Thank you.
Thank you, Cynthia. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. We're embarking on week two of the People Conference, and I just want to thank all of our ERG leaders who have helped put these amazing sessions together. This morning, we're going to talk about style differences, and we all know, thanks to Aspire, that all styles get results. But for extroverts and introverts, it can sometimes be challenging to understand one another and drive the best results possible without driving one another into frustration or exhaustion in the process. Thankfully, today's speaker has made it her life's work to help all of us improve team effectiveness by better understanding both introverts and extroverted styles. Before we get started, I want to ask you to picture your team, the people you work with most often to keep Black & Veatch's mission alive and strong. Now, what would it look like if you could double the effectiveness of that team? Jennifer Kahnweiler, today's speaker, says you can do that by tapping into the wisdom and influence of both introverts and extroverts. Jennifer is an author and global speaker who is called the champion of introverts. Her best-selling books, The Introverted Leader, quiet influence, the genius of opposites, and creating introvert-friendly workplaces have been translated into 17 languages. Jennifer has consulted with hundreds of organizations, including NASA, Capital One, the CDC, and Amazon. She's run leadership programs from Singapore to Spain and has been featured in Forbes, Time Magazine, and the Wall Street Journal. While Jennifer herself is an extrovert, her husband Bill is an introvert. And side note, he'd like to thank us for booking her so he can have some quiet time. And today she's going to show us how to harness the talent of our entire workforce, including our introverts and our extroverts. Jennifer, welcome to Black and Veatch.
Oh, Katie, thank you so much. And thank you everybody for making time this morning, afternoon, evening for this program. I hope we are very interactive, as has been shared. And I do want to give a shout out to the committee who's been incredible. They've been stellar in helping put this together. You know, I was remembering before I got on the call today about a class that I took, that I was teaching actually, a leadership development class a number of years ago. It was all engineers and it was about, you know, leadership skills. And there was a young man in the class named Sean. Sean was very quiet throughout the few days. And so one of the breaks on the last day, I went up to him and asked him how it was going for him. And he said, well, I'm learning some things, thank you, but you know, I'm not gonna really ever have an opportunity to advance at my organization. And I asked him why, and he said, well, everybody moves very fast, they talk very fast, they're kind of on the fast track, and that's just not my temperament. He didn't use the word introvert, but I kind of guessed that he might be. You know, so I put my coaching hat on and I tried to convince him and give him a little pep talk. You know, people like Warren Buffett and Bill Gates and so many successful leaders are introverts. But, you know, I could tell he was just humoring me. He didn't really buy it. You know, after that time, I realized that was really a turning point for me, as many other examples like that occurred as I was working in organizations and workplaces, that introverts were oftentimes overlooked and ignored and misunderstood. And I'm not sure what happened to Sean or the Seans like him, whether his company decided to take another look at this talented person and not put so much on the fact that he was introverted and start to change their cultures. I don't know that. Or maybe he left, and that's oftentimes the case. But that did set me on a path. And as was mentioned, I've been married to an introvert my entire life. So I have a lot at stake in making the relationship work here. And so I've learned a lot along the way, and I want to pass that on. So what we're going to do today, if we're going to take a look at some of our objectives in the time that we have together, a couple of areas I'd like to cover here. And one is the idea about what introversion is. You know, I've been in this space, as Katie mentioned, for a long time. It's been about 15 years, and we've seen a real evolution in understanding about introversion and extroversion. So I kind of want to do some level setting here at the beginning and maybe explode some myths and also bring out what the strengths are of introverts. And then we're going to take a look at what introverted leaders do across the world to be successful. And the key here is not to change themselves, but to build on the wonderful, incredible strengths that introverts have. And then the last thing is a very exciting area, and this is what's happening in companies like Black and Veatch and others, where you all are taking a look at the workplace and inclusivity. And so what we're seeing now is a movement to not just ask people to adapt to an extroverted culture, but also what are best practices that are happening within organizations, where they're taking a look at, you know, let's make this an environment where we cater to both temperaments, and that way we get tremendously more strong results than we would otherwise. So let me ask you this. We want to, and by the way, we are going to have you guys do an action step at the end. So you'll be leaving with something tangible that you can use actually today. So we're going to do a few polls. And the first poll, we just want to get a sense of the group itself and how you identify. So maybe you took an assessment, maybe you kind of guessed. There's one on our website, jennifercomwaller.com, if you're not really sure if you want to take that afterwards. But let's see who's in the room. So are you an introvert, extrovert, or not sure? And that it would be interesting to come up with. Those results are coming in now. And I'm not looking at the results, but I'm going to make an educated guess from having done a lot of these that we may have more introverts in the classroom, in the virtual classroom. And it'd be interesting to to take a look at that and see. And it looks like our results are coming in now. Let me know when you guys are going to close it. But it looks like overwhelmingly we have introverts. And thank you, extroverts, for coming too. And those of you who aren't sure, maybe by the end of the session, you will have a better sense of where you fall. Not to put you in a box, but what preferences you have. So we had 66%. Those of you who might not be able to see the chat. 66% introverts, 21% extroverts, and some are not sure. And, you know, I think part of that might be the organization that you have might skew more introverts, considering you have a more technical organization, but there are a lot of people who are not engineers who might not fall into that category, project managers. So it's really interesting to see that we don't have more extroverts that show up, but it might also be the culture and the makeup of the demographics, which we don't know. All right, so that's a good starting point. Let's talk a little bit now about what the idea of introversion and extroversion is. So the baseline definition, and this comes from a psychologist who really first coined the term, some of you may have had in your psychology classes, Carl Jung, in the late 1800s. And what he defined introversion as was where you got your energy from, and introverts, he said, get their energy from within. He also said, by the way, that nobody is completely introverted or extroverted. And I think a lot of us would agree with that. But where does the energy come from? Now, extroverts get their energy, according to the traditional definition of extroversion, from outside themselves. They like to go and do and be outside with people and with events. Now, that doesn't mean introverts don't love people. That is absolutely a myth. But it's what are the doses that you can take as an introvert? And that's kind of when does your battery run out? And an introvert's battery might go, an extrovert's battery might probably go a little bit longer where it's charged up by being out in the world and having stimuli. And that's a key word here. How much stimulus can you take? And so the introverts who are self-aware know that, for instance, if they're at a social event, that they're going to need to take a break either before or afterwards, or work out ways to manage that. So stimulation is a key theme that you may want to think about as you're thinking about your own identifying factors, and also the people in your world, on your teams, in your families, is a big part of it. Now, you see here, we have a bell curve. And the reason that that is up there is that it is a spectrum. That nobody really is a pure introvert or extrovert, as I mentioned. You do have people that call themselves hermits. I have one person who I know calls himself a hermit, an entrepreneur who's a hermit. And extroverts, you might have some friends, or you yourself might be what they might jokingly call a flaming extrovert. You know, somebody's really out there. But most of us kind of are sort of more in the middle. We use both our strengths on both areas that I'll talk about in a sec what those strengths are. But we tend to have a slight preference, even if it's slight, for one over the other. So it's kind of interesting. And once you have that awareness, like I did, fortunately, many years ago, when I took that first test assessment, it really helped me to not judge people as much when they didn't speak up, or understand that when somebody was very verbal and they just had to express all their thoughts through their talking, that I realized that they might skew on the extrovert side. And it's just another lens, like all kinds of diversity, inclusion. What we want to look at is just, it's another way, another pair of glasses that we might look through. Now, a lot of people ask, what is shyness? And that's really around psychological or social anxiety. And that can be debilitating, but they don't always go together. Extroverts can be shy, and a lot of people are surprised by that. So let's take a look at what some of the strengths are. But before we put that slide up, I want to ask you in the chat, what do you think is a key strength of an introvert? There are many, but I'd love to see what you all are thinking. And Krista said she's an ambivert. Okay, so some people they identify with that term. So Kim, if we see any come in there about what are some of the strengths, and as where those are coming in, you know, let's take a look at the slide that populates with what the strengths are. So observers, listeners, Catherine said. Yeah, I can see those on my screen, so that's good. Listening comes up a lot. We see that observing and having that eagle eye. So you kind of wrap it up at the end of the meeting and it totally makes sense for people. I love this quote that some of you might know, I have a podcast called Introvert Ally, where we look at different shades of introversion. And Doug Conant was a guest who was the former CEO of Campbell Soup. And what he said is the worlds I create are listening worlds. The worlds I create are listening worlds. I thought that was a beautiful way for an introvert to describe how the place they live in. And many introverts are known for that. And it doesn't mean you're passive when you're listening. You're engaged, using things like open-ended questions, paraphrasing to really be present with people. So that's really key. So maybe we take a look now of all those on this. There we go. You can see some others that have come up that you guys might have mentioned as well. Yeah, analytical could be extroverts too. Kimberly writes that, but that also might be when you're in your head, you're using a lot of analysis. And some of those may be surprising to you or maybe not. The one at the bottom, I think, is really critical. And that's when we did research on influence and quiet influence and what introverts do to make a difference, to challenge the status quo. It's really around that quiet time. And, you know, again, an example of how our organizations are so skewed towards meetings, towards talking things out, when we know that a lot of the great inventions of all time have come when people have gone into their silence, into their isolation and done deep, deep thinking. So why don't we honor that more, right? Comfortable with silence. There we go. Okay, so you guys can see there are some preferences here that you may relate to if you are more one of those 88 people or 68% of the people that answered. Okay, why don't we just give the extroverts a shout out here? I always laugh that, well, the extroverts get a lot of airtime, you know, so, but we still want to take a look at what are the strengths of extroverts, because we don't want to get judgmental here, right? What kind of a role can the extrovert play on a team or the qualities? So you have anything you want to put in the chat about what extroverts do well? Let's just take a look at that for a minute. And as those are coming, push ideas forward. I love outspoken. You know, a lot of introverts will admire the fact that extroverts will say what's on their mind. And you know, Ani said, like, think on their feet. That's a kind of a winging it sort of thing. It is something that also introverts admire. You know, they kind of get the group together. Networking, yeah, but we'll talk about networking a little bit, because that also introverts do, but in a different way. Okay, great. So why don't we shoot those characteristics up there, and let's see how well they matched to what some of our great ideas in action and suggestions are here. You know, Kristen said, take risks. That very well could be as well. Drawing people out, you know, a facilitator role. You can see that's on here too. Talking out their idea. Now, the focus on breath on the left is interesting, because I mentioned that introverts tend to go deep with relationships, with projects. And extroverts kind of like more, like they get bored. We saw this a lot during COVID when they don't have several plates that they're juggling, you know, so they need, again, related to stimulation. It's kind of good to know about that. And then the thriving in larger groups is an interesting one. I know we're all so much on meetings, whether we're, you know, in the office and also Zooming or teaming. You're thriving. Extroverts like a lot of like that discussion, that, you know, connection between different people. Whereas we want to balance that with the introvert propensity for smaller groups. So why not on these calls use the, you know, facility of doing breakout groups more? I always wonder why we don't use those more, because you can go deeper and then you can bring it back to the group and have a lot of that energy happening. So that's a great example of how you use both sensibilities to have an effective meeting, for instance. And I know you all are doing a lot of those. All right, so let's move on then. We're talking about what the strengths are and what an introvert is, kind of creating the definition. But we also want to say that, you know, the important things to mention, that if we're not getting input and ideas, if the introverts aren't feeling comfortable to speak up, or if we're not addressing them in the way they want to be giving their ideas or their creativity, perhaps writing, other strategies, what happens? We are losing, you know, the input from about 50% of our group, because if the estimates are, we're talking between 40 and 60% of the world is made up of introverts. So boy, what an incredible loss. If we think about that, it's not a nice to have, it's really a must have, that we include people. We did a survey of 240 introverts back right before COVID, like 2018. I don't think the results would be I hope they'd be different, but they had the exact same number that came up. It was around 49.999% of people saying that that their organizations didn't really take their ideas seriously, did not ask them for the ideas. And so that was really concerning to me and to many others. But, you know, hopefully with this awareness about introversion, we're seeing changes. So that's a good thing. So let's shoot it back to you right now. We'll do the next question here. I'd like you to think about an introvert. Let's personalize this, who made a difference to you, and put their name in the chat. Now, this could be like a teacher, a parent, some other influential figure who really saw some positives in you and encouraged you. You know, as you're putting yours in, I can think about my uncle Syke, who was a man who spoke very little English from Eastern Europe, and he would talk a language of Yiddish, which was a combination of Polish and German and a couple others I can't think of right now. But I didn't understand a lot of what he said. But what I did understand is that he showed me a lot of unconditional love. And he would say, Shana Madelon, and we would go down to his little barber shop in Brooklyn. And I remember him so vividly, and that difference that he made to me just by showing that love, you know. And so I think we've all had people, you know, we remember the names of those teachers, right, who we had in elementary school, even, who saw something in us when we doubted ourselves. You know, and people are putting things in here like family, brother, that's great. And several of you have teachers. And I think we honor them when we bring them into the room, you know, and even into the virtual room. And these are quiet people. One of my twins is very much of an introvert. And then once you have that understanding, it's like, oh my God, there were so many people. My best boss, you know, in my case was, and some of you might have it as well. And then there was a wonderful, thank you guys for sharing that. There was a wonderful person on TV when my kids were little in the 80s, they used to watch, and 90s, they would watch Fred Rogers, who some of you I'm sure have heard of. Or I think the modern version is Daniel Tiger or something like that. Anyway, the next one with Fred Rogers picture, he asked people the same question that, you know, I asked I asked you, who made a difference to you? He was extremely introverted, but made such a difference in getting even legislation passed for children's television, and was just an incredibly inspiring person. For those of you who weren't aware of him, in our country, we had him on TV like every day. And anyway, he made such a difference. And he would also he also followed that question up when he was receiving an award from the Lifetime Emmy Award. And he asked people in the audience, you know, besides remembering them, he said, wouldn't they be proud of you now? Wouldn't they be proud of you now? And you saw all these celebrities like with tears going down their throats, their faces, you know, and it's just showing the incredible impact that people can have. And I think in particular, quieter influencers. So let's just take a look at some of the other examples of people to bring them into the room as well. You know, some people are surprised at people like Oprah, for instance, is an introvert and talks about it now. And, you know, Arianna Huffington, Tim Cook, the head of Apple. And let's take a look at some of the extroverts to give them their due. You know, they work together, like Serena and Venus is an this is Serena, but Venus is Williams is an introvert. So they made themselves better, right, by working together. The elder gentleman on the top right is one of the Wright brothers, Wilbur Wright, who was the opposite of his brother. And without them, we wouldn't be complaining on planes now, for sure. And then, of course, Steve Jobs, Mark Cuban from Shark Tank, Sarah Blakely, you know, but so many people are, you know, whether they're introvert or extrovert, they work together with others to make a difference. All right, so we were talking about some of the challenges, and I just want to throw a few of those out there and see if you all have any others you want to add here. But the meeting fatigue has been an issue that keeps coming up with my clients and with readers. They talk a lot, and we're getting some good clapping hands there, you know, just like, should we meet, you know, are we managing those meetings? And my contention is a lot of the times we're not. And that's not an introvert-friendly practice when you don't do an agenda, when you don't tell people what they might want to be contributing, give them a heads up. It's really doing a disservice to everybody, but particularly to the introverts who like preparation. People exhaustion, just scheduling too much in to that point earlier about overstimulation. And then lack of quiet spaces. Now that we're coming back into the office, many companies are like yours coming back in hybrid. I think it's a wonderful opportunity to take a look at this, because on our surveys, what we found is that people said that spaces were starting to change, you know, as offices were being redesigned from those awful cube farms that we have. You know, yeah, that's an opinion, but it was just too much congestion. But then they started to create these quiet spaces, you know, these huddle rooms, these areas. I was in Silicon Valley doing some research, and, you know, and you would see just incredible, beautiful areas of plants for sensory, stimulation in a good way. You'd see areas that were quiet for people to just go and meet in small groups or just individually. But what's happened is a lot of times we put that out the window, because when people start coming back, we start filling those spaces with boxes and with other things, become storage rooms, which you don't want to happen. You want to, you know, maintain the integrity of the space. And I interviewed some design firms that were really committed to helping organizations do that. And I think that really creates a place that people want to come into. In fact, some of the recent research from Gensler, which is a design firm, we had a counterintuitive response to why people are enjoying coming back. And one of those was that they can focus. And then when you think about it, it kind of does make sense, right? When you come to work, you can focus. All right, so rather than be distracted at home. All right, so we have a couple of quotes here I just want to throw up. And one is, this came from our survey too. Please ask me if I'd like to be on a team project or conversation rather than assume I'll invite myself in. And then we also have on the next one a quote from Caroline McGregor, who is a senior leader at Merck, who's very introverted. And she says, it's who I am in the most significant way that I feel different. Introversion informs my approach to leadership and self-awareness, and leveraging an introvert's strengths have made me a better leader. So that is a really powerful quote. She actually went around her organization and did a presentation on introversion. And the people that I spoke with who have heard that, she did it, by the way, through the ERGs, like your people conference, and but were just incredibly moved and felt very inspired to see leaders like that actually self-disclosing. And we found in our research that makes a huge difference when senior leaders can actually come out as introverted. Okay, so what I wanted to move now into was the part I mentioned about the introverted leadership model, or just like what do introverted leaders do that is so successful? And I'm just going to walk through this briefly. There's a whole book about it that I'm going to encourage you to take the free assessment on our website. And then if you want to read some sample chapters, that's also there. We try to provide a lot. But I do want to share with you, you know, that there are some things that I mentioned earlier about preparation. These are the four steps that we see introverted leaders take. And one of them is to prepare, is to build on that strength that you all have. And I think we all can benefit, introverts and extroverts. In fact, I've become a lot more conscious of taking the time, instead of running from meeting to meeting, you know, to really prepare. And it goes so much better, whether any kind of a situation that I'm in work-wise. And I think that other part that we forget about that's been really helpful is many folks told me that they also pay attention to their body. And I think we heard that earlier in your prelude that was mentioned, you know, about mirroring and just being conscious of our breath, you know, of stretching. Everybody stretch right now. You know, are you standing? Are you getting up from your chair? You know, I know my watch advises me to do that, and I don't always listen, I have to admit. And so I think that another part of that preparation is anticipating questions that might come up. I know a lot of people say they're like nervous about speaking up, but if you kind of know what the agenda is, you can prepare some remarks to do that. So use that sweet spot. I think just warming up and taking the time to do that. The second area is presence, and that's being focused on the present moment. The third I'll just mention briefly, and then I'll go back. So pushing is stepping beyond your comfort zone and practicing. It's refining and sharpening your expertise. Being focused on the moment is really actually listening and building on that listening skill. I have a mentor. I had a mentor who passed away last year, Dr. Jean Greisman, and I he used to call me up and say he was very organized in his communication. And he was actually an impersonator or an interpreter of Abraham Lincoln. So he studied Lincoln and how he communicated. And Gene would say to me, he'd say, Jennifer, I have two questions and a comment I want to share with you, or a thought and two questions. So just even by saying that, I was able to be present with him, right? Because I was listening for that question. I was listening for that thought. It just gave some organization to the conversation. So, you know, that to me was an example of really being present. When my daughter, Jessie, was 6 years old, she was creative and she was dancing in the driveway to, dance singing in the rain with her little Hello Kitty, you know, cassette recorder. You can see how her age there, right? And I remember coming home from work and stopping my car at the end of the driveway and seeing her like singing in the rain, dancing in the rain. She was so in Jessie's world. And then she caught my eye and it was kind of over. She, you know, did what 6-year-olds do. She threw her umbrella down. She ran in the house. She was so involved in the moment. And, you know, I think about that when I think about how many distractions we allow ourselves to fall prey to, but how we also interrupt others. And that's a word to the extroverts, actually, by the way. And I have a T-shirt that I did a contest on my website. And the T-shirt says, I hate it. This was from extroverts. I hate it when people talk while I'm interrupting. So I think we all as extroverts need to recognize that. And then pushing is stretching. It's not going further. You like that T-shirt, somebody. It's going beyond your comfort zone, but not so much that you're going to pull a muscle. You want to make it so it's a gentle push, but you're learning and growing. And all the senior leaders that I've talked with in these fireside chats have all talked about that, how they're continuing to stretch themselves. The other day I interviewed Dr. Ivan Meisner for the podcast. He's considered the father of networking. Sarah, okay, I'll get you that shirt. Make sure you send me your email. You were one of the first ones. And so as a father of networking, he gave me a tip that I thought was wonderful. I'm going to pass it on to you all. He shared this tip. He said, one of the things we realize related to body language is that if you stand face to face with somebody, let's say you're in a reception, people feel very nervous. They're not going to come over and interrupt that conversation, or you feel very awkward about doing it. Some of the extroverts might, but the introverts definitely wouldn't. But he said, if you just turn and try standing, if you guys want to try that now and get used to kind of get it into your memory bank, if you just turn 45 degrees and then the other person is 45 degrees, then you will find that people will come up to you. And he said, we tried this experiment in all kinds of sizes rooms. And it was incredible just with that little turn of the body. You're still talking to this individual, but somebody won't feel like they have to interrupt you to get in. So I'd like you all to experiment with that. That's an example of a push strategy. So, and then finally, the practice I mentioned, this is the virtuosos do this. I like classical music. I love how they keep getting better. I love comedy. We all do, but Jerry Seinfeld keeps performing. Why does he? He's a virtuoso, right? You know, you just can't stop practicing. And then what the funny thing is, some of you tell me if this is true in the chat, that some of you who are introverted who have really been working on a full range of your behavior have also found that people will say to you, you are not an introvert. They'll kind of like challenge you. Just like, yes, I am. I need my alone time. Does anybody have that come up? That's because you've been using your 4 P's, by the way. You've been practicing and working on this stuff. Again, to know who you are. Yup, several people said true. Good. That I think I need to write an article about that. Not to change who you are, right? All right, great. So we are going to now go into the another quote here I just wanted to share with you. This is like Sean. I think our organizational culture supports diversity, but in practice, the person with the loudest voice typically drives the conversation. Amen. Let's do a poll question then. But I need a nap, says Jen. I love the sense of humor, by the way. And then several of you agreed. I'm friendly and can chat, but then I need a nap. This is great. Yeah, the humor brings us closer. So the next poll question is coming up, and that has to do with you just that question that we mentioned earlier, that introverts are encouraged. We're getting into like the cultural part of this, right? So we're asking introverts, yeah, develop, become who you are, the best version of yourself. But then what is your culture? What is your team doing? And so introverts are encouraged to express their views in meetings. Okay, let's see what's coming up here at Black and Veatch, where you guys are doing well and where there might be some work, some opportunities. It looks like the agree is coming out as the highest. Together we strongly agree about over 70, well, about approximately 70%, and only 26% disagree. Okay, so those were the people that we'd want to like take a look at or have you guys look at what's happening there that's not allowing you to express either you or people around you to express themselves. And it might not be intentional. You might have an extroverted person who's leading meetings who's just, or somebody who's, let's not even say extroverted, who's not aware of temperament. And so the same people keep talking, but they don't realize that what they need to do is shift things and hear from other people and go around the room, perhaps with a 1 minute structure. I want to hear from everybody 1 minute. You're putting in place other tools that will get people to start to engage, like writing and then speaking. Like, let's everybody answer this question. We have tons of tools and suggestions in this book, Creating Introvert-Friendly Workplace, a whole chapter on what you can do with your team to do that, that we don't have time to do today. But I'm glad to know that things are going okay. And there's always possibility to improve. So yeah, the last part I do want to talk about here, or one of the last parts is, it has to do with the workplace and what we looked at. So we can throw those all up on there now. And these were the seven areas that are that you can assess yourself. Again, we have a quiz on the website at jenniferconwaller.com. So you can see how you feel your team or organization are doing in these various areas. And so one has to do, I'm just going to review these briefly and then do a kind of a more of a deeper dive on, or a semi-deeper dive on one of them. So talent has to do with, you know, what are you doing in terms of your talent management strategy? Are you including the introvert idea? I'm going to come back to that one. Leadership has to do with, you know, are your leaders self-aware? You know, are you taking assessments to or professional development, such as these people conference and going even further, coaching to really understand, you know, yourself? I love this quote from Brené Brown, who many of you know her work, who we are in her book on leadership. Who we are is how we lead. Who we are is how we lead. I couldn't agree more. Would you all agree with that? Who we are is how we lead. If we don't know ourselves, then how can we, look at all the thumbs up, then how can we be effective with other people? We have to confront our biases, right? We have to share our vulnerabilities, share our weaknesses, share our strengths, our successes. And, you know, I mentioned the self-disclosure about just simply saying, you know, Doug Conant was one of the early people when I got a call from the Wall Street Journal, a reporter many years ago, he was still CEO of Campbell. And she said, listen, Doug's the only person who will talk to me. And you're the, you know, I need to have more than just the expertise on the in the article, we need to have other CEOs, but nobody will go on the record and say they're introverted. But that, you know, fortunately that's changed. And once you start having those conversations, we do these fireside chats, it's incredible, you know, how much freedom people start feeling comfortable to be themselves, their whole selves at work. So leadership's an important part. Communication, again, setting up a climate of psychological safety. The design, we've talked a little bit about the design of the workplace, both for your remote situation, but also, I mean, your hybrid, you know, when you're at home, but also in your workplace. So the three areas there to consider is, you know, are you allowing possibilities for collaboration, for socialization, you know, could be the mingling that happens, you know, that's informal mingling that we missed when we're home, to learn more about people, to learn what their projects are, to learn where the synchronicity is. And then the third thing, so it's collaboration, socialization, and focus, as I mentioned. So are you giving people an opportunity to do heads down, not have to work together all the time, but do that as well? And then we have the, there should really say hybrid work is really relevant to you right now, which more organizations are doing, by the way, as we speak, because they're realizing the importance of coming in. I just talked to Bosch yesterday. They've been doing that for a long time too, Bosch Research, and they've seen a real opportunity to bring people in for collaboration like you are as well. And then teams, what can we do to strengthen our teams? So we talked about engaging our introverts. Many teams are doing team assessments. So you're looking at introversion, but other areas too, as well. And learning, all the, you know, I think we had an opportunity because we were forced to go to virtual learning over these last few years. And how do we integrate that in virtual and live and discussion and reflection? There's many modalities now and on-demand learning where we can do it individually. So it's, having been in the learning space a long time, I'm very excited about, you know, how we can adapt these learning processes and think about that with a true strategy. So they were getting some great comments here. I hope we saved the chat. I think we are. So I do want to do, I mentioned a little bit of a deeper dive on one of these areas just to give you a sense of how you can explore it, because I know talent is an issue. Acquisition and, retention. Yeah, retention as well. So if we can move to the next one there. We're going to skip over that poll. Let's go to that picture next about the, we have two guys with the beers, right? And so, you know, there, a lot of people would hire people because they want to be a person they can have a beer with, you know, and that's sort of just tongue in cheek. But if we move to the next thing, some of the things that you can consider when you are involved in any aspect of the hiring process, there's five different areas. So on the next slide, we have consider the introvert-extrovert connection to the job. Is it really important that person be very articulate, be speaking up all the time? Is that really related to the competencies? And I think we sometimes do a disservice to people. Or if they don't interview very well, we think, oh, we just write them off. Well, I don't think they can fit into our culture. Well, there's so many examples of that not being true that I want to share that in just a moment. You know, have a robust online presence, so that people are researching you, particularly introverts might not be talking to you, but they're looking and researching, going deep. And there are some other suggestions there too that, you know, we have a lot more in the book on. And then the next quote I thought was very powerful. Susan Schmidt Winchester really started at Rockwell 10, a whole program that looked at temperament as part of the hiring process. And she said on her quote, she was somewhat slow in her responses, thoughtful and reflective, which led some interviewers to think she may not be right for the role. This was a woman who everybody else wanted to pass over, but her skills, knowledge, and experience and education were super strong, and her capacity for complexity and conceptual capability were outstanding. She ended up becoming vice president. This was an introverted person who would have just been discounted. And then I think we can skip a couple. I want to make sure that we allow enough time for some of the Q&A. So if we just skip a couple of the slides that I'll make available to people, but I don't think we need to spend time on those now. If we can just go to the one with the picture, 8451 at the top of it. It would be slide 24. There's a little bit of a delay, I think. Yeah, so Joyce, good comment. Thank you. It's so hard for me to respond well when put on the spot. You know, I'm so pleased about knowing that the People Conference has been spearheaded by the Women's ERG with the collaboration of others. And, you know, I think the ERGs are such a powerful way to, you know, feel supported, to really get connected with people that you can relate to, to make a difference and to spread the word, like you all are sponsoring this conference. I was so pleased to learn that there are introverted ERGs that maybe after this program, you all would like to start one. And they have been extremely successful. This was one of the first ones. And I thought the name was so cute, Itopia, which was a data analytics firm out of Cincinnati. They reached out to me, and they were kind of a leader in the field. Now Amazon, Google, many companies have them. And they're, you know, set up as ERGs as yours is. So I love that whole idea. Love you to consider it. And let's see, we had another example here. Oh, there's a team member user manual on the next slide, just to give you guys an idea of other best practices. This, you can find this online. This is the next slide, team member user manual. Really what it does is it says to people, and you can use any format for it. It says to people how you like to be communicated with. So I think that's really critical. And then as we wind down here, I just want to have two more slides then. The one after this one, create an introvert-friendly workplace. So this is, I want you to all think about this. I'm sorry, I got my leaf blower. So they always pick the worst time. So create an introvert-friendly workplace has a couple of ideas in here that have really addressed what we've really been covering in this program. You know, you can, in addition to that, with knowledge comes power, and you can speak up in all kinds of ways. People have passed on books. They brought it up in staff meetings. They've just, in the moment, you know, encourage your team to really address introversion or just at least talk about it. A quick example, I was at a retreat last year, and the person who designed it, the team had created very, very extrovert friendly retreat. And finally, one of the introverted participants, you know, just stood up and raised her hand and said, can we slow it down? We need time. We need break times. We need to make this room a quiet room. They had all kinds of great ideas. But in our planning, let's be intentionally address needs. Let's look at our projects. Let's look at our events that we're having to involve introverts. In your research, just ask, you know, just ask. Encourage teams to address it. And then I mentioned bringing senior leadership into the conversation. I'd love you all to tune into the Introvert Ally. We've had some incredible guests. We're launching season two with people who've been leaders and really in the field and have really been giving us many ideas of how we can step up and be a voice for the quiet. It is a revolution. We are seeing people stop and say, is there just one way to do this? Extroverts are great, but we need to really listen to our introverts. So that's been my, and you know, as Katie said, my life journey. I'd like to leave on the encouraging note here. As an introvert my whole life, I have often felt like I've had to conform to an extroverted business world. I now feel like I've been given permission to cultivate my introverted leadership style. And for that, I'm so grateful. And that's what I wish for each of you as we move forward. So I think we have some time for some Q&A, Kim, if I'm not mistaken.
We do. We have such a great discussion going on in the chat. So are you ready for a couple of questions?
Great.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Yes. Okay. So one thing.
I just need to tell my leaf blower. Can you hear the leaf blower? Is it okay?
No, we can't hear it.
Okay. Good. I'm glad. Okay. Have a good night. Okay. Sorry. Okay. Yeah. Tell me the first one.
Mm-hmm. That's one thing both introverts and extroverts have to do. You have to go with the flow sometimes, right?
You were right.
Yes. Okay. So one thing that keeps coming up in the chat is in meetings. So talk about this from the perspective of the person who it's happening to and like how to run meetings. So some people are saying that through meetings, people don't pause enough to give them time to maybe think or digest or even answer back. By the time they come up with an answer, the person's already moved on and they've lost their moment. How can we make that better?
Right. Okay. So I think there are different ways. I think you got the pre-meeting and then you have the meeting, because it's going to happen in both situations, right? If you can be proactive and talk with other person one-on-one before, even just a few minutes, the way we did before this call, and just say, can we just slow it down, or put your request in there? Say, can we give people a chance to think a little bit, you know? And depending on your relationship with the facilitator, you don't always feel comfortable doing that, but that avoids things. That's a ground rule. Remember we used to have ground rules at meetings? Well, that I think we need to bring them back, you know? Then when the meeting actually happens, sometimes it's rather than, I don't know if these are virtual, these are virtual live, that could be a little bit different, but even so, a nonverbal, like slow down, like stop. A lot of times the people that are extroverted that are just ramming over everyone, they're not even aware. They don't even take a second to breathe, right? So we need that. We need you to say, could you hold on, you know, like put, stop it in the moment. I don't know. Have you done anything yourself to make that happen? Kim, throwing it back at you.
I didn't know you were going to do that.
No, I know. I didn't give you a chance to plan. It's okay.
I try to pause whenever I kind of bring up a new topic and just let everyone in the room talk. People need, you know, different times to process. So I think having a actual pause between topics or between agenda items is important for whether you're an introvert or an extrovert.
Absolutely. And again, that's a suggestion you make. One thing that's helpful. One thing we also have done in meetings, and this is a non-threatening way if you don't feel like you want to like confront the person, you can suggest, and this is an old, really strong meeting practice, that you do a plus and a delta at the end of the meeting. Like what went well? I'd like to just suggest, we've been meeting a few times. I'd like to just suggest that we just go around and say what people think's working well about our meetings. And what do you think we could improve? And that's kind of a non-threatening thing where you can kind of throw that in. It's like, maybe we can pause, you know, make a suggestion in a gentle way. So you have to do what you're comfortable with. But again, being proactive is oftentimes the better way.
One thing I have tried to do, and tell me if this is more putting people on the spot. If you notice someone like in a meeting, even if it's a Teams meeting or a live meeting, who's really not saying anything, to actually maybe call upon them. I don't know if that puts more pressure on them, or does that actually give them the opportunity then to maybe say something? What do you think of that technique?
I think we should ask the group, but many people feel like they're being singled out that way. And so I think that you have to read the person. If you know the person, you know, that I think that's important. Now, one of the things, if you know that person doesn't usually contribute, right? If you meet with them, then you can, you give them a heads up before. And many introverts will say they appreciate this. Like even just, I remember one person saying, my boss would walk by my desk and just say, listen, I'd like you to put your point of view on this that I'm going to bring up. And she was like, oh, thank God he's doing that. Because I'll be ready, you know? So yeah, I think you have to, and you could even ask that person, you know, I'd love to hear from you more. Now you put in structured ways, like I mentioned, the 1 minute rule where the 1 minute where everybody talks for a minute and then you keep going around, or, you know, we've done things where you want to get the take of the group and you're not hearing from certain people, you can use, like a lot of people here have been using some of these symbols. But you also can say, okay, red, you'd like to stop this. Yellow, you'd like to, you know, you have some caution. Green, you want to go ahead. That gets everybody talking, and then you can engage from there. I also mentioned the smaller groups, right? Like it's okay to, even with a small meeting, to say we're going to do like two, we're going to break up into twos for 5 minutes.
Yeah, Teams have an often capabilities of breakout chat sessions, so we probably should use that. That is getting a lot of interesting chatter. Some people like some of those techniques, and some are proposing other techniques. So read the chat; very, very fascinating. Another topic that comes on a lot is people are talking about, they almost feel as an introvert that they have to overcome, one person put in quotes, their introvertness in order to be able to succeed. What is your advice for people that feel that? And then kind of along the lines, another one asks, if you're trying to overcome something like that, then are you yourself being authentic?
No, you're not. Is my you know, suggestion. I think that's where relationships in your organization and mentoring come in. And I'm not saying you have to have a formal mentor, but I would like you to watch those people who are successful, who are quieter or are more introverted. See how they don't even need to know your mentor, they're your mentor. See how they're maneuvering, okay? And still staying true to who they are. See how they take pauses, you know, how they relate to people one-on-one and develop deeper relationships. To me, that's a lot of it, where people fall down is they think they have to change. But no, once you get to know people, it's, organizations are made up of relationships, you know. And I saw this done beautifully. When I worked at GE years ago, my boss was like the expert at this. I mean, we had no power at our department in organization, but because she developed strong relationships, I just watched her do it with the key players or with people that could help us. And that's a lesson for all of us. I don't know if the rest of you guys agree with that. You know, relationships.
Yeah. So a lot of this is talking about the ability to flexible a little bit. I mean, there are great qualities of introverts. There's great qualities of extroverts. How can people, and we're all somewhere in the middle usually, right. How can people like have the best of both worlds and kind of flex maybe depending on what is called for the situation or maybe who they're working around?
It's awareness. And I think when you say the situation, you want to use that preparation again. Like, what am I going into now? You know, is it with somebody that is a lot more senior than me? What messages am I telling myself in my head? Am I gonna prepare something that I can say so I'm more confident? You know, again, it's preparation. So, and it's the awareness of you and what you want to try doing, pushing yourself a little bit. You know, also, like, I want, this is an opportunity for me to stretch, just as it is for us extroverts to be quiet. I interviewed this guy Ferez, who said to me it was the hardest thing in the world for him in a meeting, and this. For him in a meeting to let three people speak before he spoke up and to sit, as somebody said here, they're uncomfortable with silence. Well, we have to get more comfortable with silence. Who is it? Thoreau, who said nature abhors a vacuum. Somebody will speak up. You just have to be patient. So it's like whatever you are working on, practice that in the situation that's in front of you.
What do you think is the one big takeaway people can, get from kind of being aware of this and put it into action immediately? Like what could people do with this knowledge today to like proactively enhance their work?
Mm-hmm. To look at what your own strengths are, take a step back and observe your team and what's working and what isn't. Take the assessment. The introvert-friendly assessment, but start with yourself.
That's been shared in the chat.
Start with yourself. You know, what's working for you? What strengths are you using? What else could you not do? I love people to put an action step. We had talked about leaving with an action step. What is something that you feel like you got from this? Because everybody's in a different place, Kim, you know?
Yeah. Hey, Mary,
we didn't tell people that you heard this. I'm sorry? What's that?
Let's share the slides one more time. And there's a couple things we want to be sure to share before the end of it here.
Exactly. So put your action step in. And we are just, as people are putting that in there, also let you know that we are going to be meeting again on Wednesday. So I hope you all will come join us at the How to Get Along with the Opposites. Right.
Yes. So Jennifer was so fabulous. We wanted to bring her in for a second session, and we appreciate you doing this. So our last day of People Conference is on Wednesday, 9:00 Central. Please join us for a conversation on how to build strong teams, because that's really important. And go back one slide, Mary. I really want to plug this for Jennifer. Jennifer is a wonderful speaker, of course. Her podcast is fascinating, but she has written these four books that are amazing. We have them in the library, I got to say that, both ebook and regular book. But Jennifer has signed three copies of her book, Creating Introvert-Friendly Workplaces, which is amazing. And we're going to pick three people from our audience today, and I will make sure the winners get a copy of that book. But you can also go on there and read a lot about it. So just wanted to plug your books, Jennifer. This has been wonderful. I know this is going to start so many conversations.
I'm sorry, as an extrovert, of course, I need to be quiet. But I was just going to say, as a librarian, you are living your passion by revering books and sharing them. So thank you so much for getting those. And I hope I look forward to staying in touch with you. I'm also on LinkedIn, so I'd love to connect with people. Feel free to send me an invite.
And some of the questions we didn't get to today, we will bring back up again on Wednesday's session. So thank you for the engagement and thank you for the discussion. And Jennifer, thank you for working with us. We really appreciate it.
My total pleasure. It's been a joy. Thank you all.